I'm seeing this in front of your eyes. Spend your whole life down trying to find the answer.
Factory78.com. This is Adeshokwe. We're out here, DJ Lanre, at the O2 Center because of just one man, Eddie Kadi. He's having his biggest show ever on the 4th of September 2010. And we decided to do it the way we do it where we're from.
Uh-huh.
Come and celebrate my brother.
Yes.
Eddie, how
yes.
you doing?
I'm not too bad, brother. I'm not too bad. Thank you for coming down.
Yeah.
You know, how far are you coming from?
We came from East London.
No, that's East London. That's too far. That's too far for you to come all the way from East London. Use yeah. your passport yeah. to get here. That's love.
That's love.
That's love. That's love.
So don't free me. Ask what's up like you can't see me. I just do what needs be.
Yeah, this is Factory78.com. Now, Eddie, I want us to go a little bit further back.
No problem.
Before we get to the O2 Center,
yes.
How did Eddie Kadi, the comedian, start about?
I started at Mama Yemo Hospital in Congo, 1983, 18th of May. That was the day I was born from two beautiful human beings.
Yeah.
And a few years later, they decided, let's run away from this country because we have run out of oxygen. So
yeah.
they seeked for oxygen here in the UK.
Yeah.
And a few years later on, they decided, you know what? We're giving our son an opportunity to now go to university. So I followed through. After I finished university is when I said to my parents, thank you for the great education. I shall now be a comedian. And they said, we're going back to Congo. So, but you know, it was an amazing feeling.
Sorry to cut you short there.
No problem.
The thing is, for any African parent, any African son,
yes,
you know that saying to your parents one day, Dad, I want to be a comedian.
Yes.
Now, how did they take that?
I didn't tell them. Are you mad? God didn't create us to be able to tell our parents such news. We don't have the capabilities of it.
Yeah.
We are not capable of receiving such news. We would die instantly before the words come out. What I did is I just showed them that I had this talent. I think naturally they knew that, you know, I finished university, I've done my studies, but I had one of those just crazy craving for performing. So I love performing, and my parents came to watch me a few times and they saw that, you know, there's something about our little son. So they just took it on board.
They
showed their concerns.
Yes.
You know, I'm blessed to have parents who are fully supporting me and the rest of my family as well, my siblings. So they showed their concerns, but eventually in time, the more they laughed, the more they eased up.
They just got
laughter is
it.
The best medicine.
And you are
the local pharmacist.
You heard it here, Factory78.com. Eddie,
yes, sir.
We're going to go to O2 Center now.
Because yes.
we're skipping quite a bit.
Yes.
We're skipping the OBE TV. We're skipping you working
yes.
at university, you know, leading
yes.
Afro-Caribbean students.
We're skipping all that.
We're skipping all that.
Fast forward.
We're going straight to the business.
Okay.
The O2 Center.
Yeah.
I want to start 2009.
Okay.
You had the first show.
I had my first show, Indigo 2 in the O2.
Yeah.
And it was amazing, you know, that because prior to that, I did, you know, smaller capacity venues, the Mermaid Theatre, the Show Theatre, and I performed all around the country.
Yeah.
But that was my first, post 1,000 show. So to have 2,000 people come and watch me was truly a blessing. It was an amazing feeling. Yeah. And so much so that we loved the feeling. We wanted to do it again. So we did it 3 months later, and it sold out again. So
wow.
that was an amazing feeling. And I come from a team that truly believed in me and my abilities.
Yeah.
And they always want to take big steps, you know. So that's how the whole O2 Arena idea came.
It came through.
Yes.
You started with 1,000, moved over to 2,000,
yes.
and you decided it's about now for the big dogs.
It's about
Let's
now.
Go for the big hog.
Yeah, you
the
know.
The O2 Arena itself, yes. 8,000 seats.
Yes, sir.
God bless. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And once he goes, I'm net. No lie.
Does that make you a little bit tentative?
You know what? It has to, you know, to keep you on your toes, because if you think you can just lie down and then turn up, people will be there, it doesn't work. Mm. So the only way for you to work and really know that work needs to be put in, yeah, is for you to be on your toes.
Yeah.
For you to think, you know what, it's a massive deal and I've got to put in the work. It doesn't happen overnight,
yeah,
but I'm blessed to be part of a fantastic team that are always encouraging me.
Yeah.
They're always behind me.
Yeah.
I remember I got bullied into doing my first stand-up gig. You know, all my friends gathered and said, you need to go on there because, you know, you've got something that we believe can you know, represent a bigger situation or a bigger idea than you yourself. So they've continued to do that same thing. They bullied me into going to the auto arena. My brother, I have no choice. In fact, in secret, you need to help me because this is the auto thing. They have bullied me, those people, right? So if I don't do it, they say they're going to send me straight back. If there's space for me in East London to seek asylum,
no, I'm sorry, we don't have any space. O2 Center, September the 4th, it has to sell out. You said something, I read something on your website.
Yes, sir.
Have you got your tent?
That's right.
Can you explain what that means?
It's as simple as this. We realize that we're part of a massive community.
Yeah.
And it's a lot easier if, you know, people are able to invite other friends and family to turn up to the show. My comedy, you know, transcends all cultures, all types of age groups. So you can have a 5-year-old and a 65-year-old grandma. So my idea is, if you can get grandma, auntie, grand auntie, granddad, you know, my cousin, you know, everyone, the dog, that's your amount to 10. If everyone can get a 10, then this event will sell out. Easy.
Sell out. Go get your 10. You heard it here. EddieKadi.com, Factory78.com. Go and get your 10.
Go and get it.
Now,
yes,
most
sir.
Comedians, sir, they've got someone, probably their close friends, family members, that's the butt of the joke. Who is the butt of the joke on EddieKadi's show?
You know, I have to be careful who I, you know, take the mickey out of. I have to be careful who I expose out there.
Yeah.
But initially, when I first started comedy, it was literally my household. I hovered around my mom and dad. That was just the pinnacle of my stories. Then my sister and my aunties. But now, you know, I feel more comfortable to talk about everyone else around me. But if you're on my show and I see you and I spot you there and then.
Oh my God.
Such is life.
Oh my God.
That's all
God.
That happens. So I don't pick anyone specifically. I just go with the flow. It's a spontaneous thing.
Yeah.
Some people like to ask me questions during my show. Some people just like to, you know, kind of elaborate on what I'm talking about from their own corner. So if I spot you, I don't need to spot you. I just need to hear you.
Hear what you said.
And then I'll chuck it back at you.
You chuck it.
But it's fun. I think they like it. I think these people actually like it. They do like it. So I give them what they want.
People come to Eddie Kadi's show
so they can get abused.
Get mocked.
Yes.
Have you heard that?
Imagine.
People come to your show to get abused.
That's it.
Now, the other part of Eddie Kadi that really made me wonder was, comedians, we know that they write materials.
Mm-hmm.
They travel all around, they take their family members, friends. How do you prepare material for such a show?
You know, because I've done a few one-man shows, I don't necessarily look at it as, okay, because it's a bigger crowd, then I have to change the way I prepare.
Mm.
I've always liked being spontaneous with my material.
Yeah.
I will write a loose set just so I'm able to keep it open in case anything enters that I didn't expect to enter.
Yeah.
So, but now, you know, I've been doing all types of circuits, so I've learned to, you know, always note things down and then elaborate. So I may go to a show, say something that I made up on the spot, really like the response, go home and then add something else to it and
that's
keep
something.
And then it just grows. Because if it comes from the heart, it feels a lot better. When when you keep writing things down and you're reading from it, sometimes it's a bit more. But for this show, obviously it has to be a lot tighter because it is a bigger audience, but at the same time also there's a bigger deal behind it. And I want to give something different to the O2.
Yeah.
I wanna be able to talk about myself a lot more in depth. So you might find out a little bit more about Eddie Kadi that you didn't know.
I never know.
It's going to be exciting.
Absolutely. Eddie Kadi.
Yes, sir.
You're African.
Yes, sir. I'm African.
You are African.
I'm African.
You see that?
I'm African.
Based in the United Kingdom.
Yes, sir.
Growing up, working from the ground up. How difficult has it been to get the audience to understand how our jokes are in the African community?
Well, speaking English is a start, you know. It's good to speak English.
Yeah.
That's a very good way to understand. The thing is, we're all human.
Yeah,
but we just have different ways of doing things. Mm. People wash clothes differently in Africa than they wash it. You know how they wash in Africa. Where there's water, there's a will.